You know, the world of English is a fun and exciting place to be. I'm so glad you could join me for another lesson. Hi everybody, this is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? I hope so. I have a question for you. When is an English word not an English word? When it's a foreign word used both inside and outside the language. In today's lesson, we are going to look at those words that may sound foreign to non-English speakers, but are commonly used by many native speakers every day. In some cases, without them even realizing it. Confused? Not for much longer, I hope, as we take a look at what I like to call Foreignglish. The English language has become one of the most spoken in the world. It has been described by some as a global language. Over the years, it has been viewed as a language of freedom and a symbol of oppression. Its use is still on the increase and remains an ever-dominating medium on the world stage. Having said that, to describe English as a unique language would be a misnomer, as we will be finding out today. Even modern spoken English regularly contains words taken straight from other languages, some examples of which we will take a close look at later. But first, let's take a close look at how it all started, with a brief history of the English language.
A brief history of the English language.
The English language was formed in four distinctive stages. In its original form, we usually refer to it as Old English. This is the earliest form of the language, which was created between 500 and 1100 AD by the invaders of ancient Britain from southern Denmark and Jutland, who were known as the Angles. The Angles, along with the Saxons and Jutes, spoke a language which in modern times became known as Old English. The word English comes from Angles, the land of Angles, which is where we get England. You could also see this influence in the French word l'Angleterre. There were four distinctive dialects of Old English: Northumbrian, Mercian, West Saxon, and Kentish, all of which were related to the different regions of early England, which still exist today as Northumbria, Mercia, Wessex, and Kent. The next big change came with the Norman conquest, led by William the Conqueror, who invaded England in 1066 AD. With this invasion came a new language. This time the integration of the French language occurred, which formed into what we now call Middle English. Through the changes caused by the realignment of power, the language of Latin was also integrated into English. The romancing of the English language was by then well underway. In fact, the Roman influence had occurred earlier, albeit in a small way, after the introduction of Christianity to England during the 7th century. It is worth noting that even at this time, the English spoken bore very little resemblance to the language we use today. But its influence on modern English cannot be ignored. A large portion of modern English words are, in essence, foreign words, which came into being during the early invasions by the Anglo-Saxons and the Vikings. From 1204 AD, a division formed. This was due to the fall of Normandy and King John to the King of France. This caused a division between France and the English Normans. The ruling class by this time were known as the nobles. The next big change occurred after the Great Plague, which wiped out a huge portion of the population and led to a surge in the so-called labouring class. These events led to another surge in the use of English as a common language. Middle English had taken hold of the country and would go on to develop yet again into what we now refer to as early modern English. With this came the period known as the Renaissance. It signalled the birth of modern literature, philosophy, and science, which would go on to shape not only this country, but also many parts of the world. From this would come what we now refer to as modern English. The English language we know today developed over two centuries. Grammar formation, punctuation, and the compiling of words into a definitive dictionary all occurred in this time. The progression from Middle to Modern English brought with it many other changes. The new formation of vowel sounds being a good example of this. When you look at the works of William Shakespeare, you can see this change occurring. The spelling and grammar look different to now. But in many instances, it is still recognisable as English. Speaking overall, we could list many influences on modern English. Greek, Latin, French, and Germanic all played a part in the formation of English. Greek and Latin words are still used in the sciences. Most parts of the human body are derived from Latin. For example, the bone in this part of your arm is called the humerus, which translates as upper arm. So, as you can see, English in its entirety is a combination of many different languages, all rolled into one, with regional dialects developing over the years and word variations existing to this very day. It is easy to see just how English evolved. Now we will look at another part of the language. This area concerns the foreign words that were literally taken from other languages but were not changed in any way. They have been assimilated or absorbed into English without being altered or changed. Let's take a look at some of these words and their definitions now. Foreign words used directly in modern English. A cappella. To sing without instrumental accompaniment. You sing without backing music. A deux. A thing for or involving two people. Ad hoc. A thing built for a particular purpose. Ad nauseam. Something done excessively that causes annoyance or discomfort. Argent provocateur. A person who lures another into committing a criminal act so they can be caught and put in prison. Al fresco. To do something in the open air, not indoors, normally associated with eating outside. Annus mirabilis, a memorable or special year. Annus horribilis, a terrible or disastrous year. Au fait, to have good or detailed knowledge of something, you are familiar with a task or object. Au naturel, something done in the most simple or natural way. Beau monde, a fashionable or chic society. Bona fide, a genuine thing, a real item,
not fake. Brasserie, a small and inexpensive restaurant, a cheap place to eat. Carte blanche, to have freedom to act as you please, to have total freedom. Cause célèbre, a controversial issue or situation that causes public attention. Compos mentis, to have full control of your own mind. You are sane, you are not mad. Coup, a sudden occurrence without warning. Coup d'etat, a sudden violent overthrowing of a government, a sudden seizure of power within a country. De facto, in fact, whether by right or not. Déjà vu, the feeling of having done something before, the feeling that time is repeating itself. Dolce vita, a life of pleasure, a carefree life. Doppelganger, the appearance of or the exact double of a living person, not to be confused with twin. Double entendre, a word or phrase with more than one meaning, often used to show that a word or sentence could have a rude meaning. Dramatis personae, the characters in a play, a list of the characters and actors playing them. Enfant terrible, a person whose behaviour attracts attention and controversy, an unconventional person. Fait accompli, a thing that has been done or decided and cannot be changed or altered. There is no going back. Faux pas, an embarrassing mistake or a blunder. You make a mistake. Femme fatale, a woman with great powers of seduction. A beautiful female character in a movie. Haute cuisine, high quality cooking. High class food that is normally expensive. In loco parentis, meaning in place of a parent, a substitute parent, often used in law as many Latin words are. Ipso facto, the exact point or fact, used in law to make a point or state an exact truth. Je ne sais quoi, to have an indescribable quality, a quality that cannot be described or expressed. It literally means, I do not know what. Magnum opus, the most important or significant work created by an artist, writer, or composer. Ménage à trois, a sexual relationship or marriage involving three people. Modus operandi, the usual way of doing something. The habits of a person, often abbreviated to MO, a criminal's MO. Non sequitur, a conclusion or statement that does not logically follow the previous one. Disjointed. Par excellence, better than or more than others of the same kind, to stand out from the rest. Per annum, for each year. Often used when talking about a person's wages or salary. He gets £20,000 per annum. Per capita, for each person. Often used while discussing statistics or numbers referring to people. Per se, by or in itself or themselves. This is often used pretentiously to highlight intellectual prowess or ability. Persona non grata, a person who is not welcome, an unwelcome guest. Piece de resistance, the highlight or best part of something, the most impressive part. This is a very commonly used phrase. Plat du jour, a special meal or dish served in a restaurant on a certain day. Pro rata, according to the rate. At the acceptable or current rate, often used when talking about money given per hour for work done. Quid pro quo, a favour or advantage given in return for something. You help me, and I will help you. You scratch my back, and I'll scratch yours. Savoir-faire. The ability to behave well in public, to display the correct manners. Sub rosa. To do something in secret, an action that is hidden from view. Terra firma. The ground. Usually referring to the ground beneath your feet. I'm glad to be back on terra firma. Tete-a-tete. A private or intimate conversation. It literally means head to head. Tour de force. A thing achieved or accomplished with great skill. Vis-a-vis. Compared with or in relation to. This is often used in law when discussing the relation of one event to another. Vox populi. Public opinion. The opinion of the general public. Nowadays shortened to vox pop. Zeitgeist. The characteristic, spirit, or mood of a certain period of time. This word is often used when talking about social attitudes.
People often ask me why I'm so fascinated by a language I have spoken all my life and use daily. Why am I not bored of hearing English spoken all the time? This would be a fair question. My love of English comes from not just how it is used, but from how it came into being used. English is more than a language. It is an essence of all which came before. It carries with it traditions, thoughts, and ways of living from over the past 900 years. The changes that have occurred indelibly left their marks on this language. As wars and invasions were carried out, and attitudes altered, so the language changed too. The marks left by the Romans, Anglo-Saxons, Vikings, and the many rulers of this country ever since have shaped the way in which English is used, right up to this very day. The historical impact of English remains with us. New countries were formed through this language, sometimes by choice and sometimes not. The modern use of English does more than merely allow dialogue to take place. It gives us a common ground. It serves as a means for us to understand each other. As I have said before, whether we agree or disagree with each other is irrelevant. The important thing is that we are all talking. I hope you have enjoyed this little look at how the English language was formed, and that you will join me again for another lesson very soon. This is Mr. Duncan in England saying thank you for watching me teaching you. See you again soon, and of course, ta-ta for now.